Hi, my name is Jeremy Walker. I'm a developer advocate at Google, and I'm joined here by Max Can Alexander. We're finishing our talk on the three software flaws in software design. So now you're going to talk a little bit about the method of software design that helps you avoid all of them. Can you give us a little more information?
So I call this system incremental development and design. I used a bunch of English words because I'm generally opposed to buzzwords. And so I just spelled it out as like a bunch of words that actually mean what they mean instead of some word that I invented to sell consulting. Now, before I start into this, let me say that as far as I know, this system works. And it always works as long as you do the actual system and not something else and don't add something to it. If you do this and it doesn't work, then you can email me and tell me. And either I will publish something that fixes what I said, or I will tell you what you did wrong. And my email address is max@codesimplicity.com. So many people have heard about incremental development, where you just write one thing, and then you write another thing on top of that, and then you write another thing on top of that. And many people practice this. What I'm adding to that is incremental development and design, because a lot of what people do is they design something up front, and then they make incremental steps toward it. But what I try to do is I try to rethink my design at every step, at every increment, I rethink my design. And what I say is, every time I want to add something new, the resulting system should look like I designed it from the beginning to do exactly what it does now. This involves a lot of refactoring. So get really good at refactoring. Okay. At first, it will be a little slower for you, but over time, it will pick up, and also you will get real good at refactoring. Like, I've got really good at refactoring after I started to do this. Like, you can do it real fast, I promise. But it's slow at first, but you know, keep it up. The only important thing is that you need to have a general notion of the order in which you should build things, because if you do things in the wrong sequence, then this system won't work. In general, you want to kind of build from the inside out. So the way that I would think about this is, like, if I was building a YouTube app, the first thing that I would build is the video player. Because that's the core of the application. That's the thing that users are actually trying to do. And you can also think of it as what produces a useful product as fast as possible, right? So like the last time I wrote a YouTube app, the first thing I did was I just made a rendering surface that could play a video. And that was it. And it's not a very useful application, but you could give it. I could have given it to a software developer and said, hey, look, you can change the video ID string in here and you can watch any video that you want. It's kind of useful. It's more useful than if I had implemented, say, the browse interface first. You don't want to be able to browse videos and not watch them. That's not useful.
Right.
But being able to watch them is useful. So you want to find the useful core and write that first. Or the example that I give in the book for ordering is like if you wanted to write a calculator that did simple arithmetic, addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, you would want to do either addition or subtraction first, probably addition, because it's sort of the base that other things build on. And then subtraction you can implement as a form of addition. And then on top of that, you can implement multiplication, because multiplication is a form of addition, right? And probably subtraction is simpler, so you probably start with that and then do multiplication. And then at finally, you do division, because division is the operation that depends on all of the other ones. The ordering of the first two is not as important, so subtraction and addition. Or whether you do subtraction or multiplication first doesn't matter. But you would never, ever want to do division first, because you wouldn't have built up all of the correct abstractions or simplicities for addition and subtraction. So let's give an example of this. So let's say that we're going to implement a socket. And we know that we need sort of Unix sockets and UDP sockets and TCP sockets. Okay. So the first step we want to do is we just decided to write a Unix socket. We've decided that that's probably the simplest socket that we need, right? And so first, we just write a class called socket and then socket test. And this follows all of our previous rules about the implementation of things for the three flaws of software design. Because you notice there's no generic system here. Like, our first step looks like we designed a system that only does Unix sockets. So there's just a class called socket, and then there's a test called socket test. Now we want to add UDP sockets. Don't do this by adding if statements. Don't hack it in. Redesign the system to look like it was originally designed to do exactly these two things. So now we create a superclass, an abstract superclass called socket, and then two subclasses called Unix socket and UDP socket. And then we create tests for both of those concrete classes. And then we might need a base class for the tests, because they might need to share information between the two tests. So they might need a utility module that has utility functions that they share. But we wouldn't write any of that. We wouldn't write any of that generic bit until we needed it. Now, the third step is we need TCP. So now we have two kinds of IP sockets. So now we need to abstract out an IP superclass that inherits from the main socket class and then gives us UDP socket and TCP socket. And this system looks exactly like it was designed to do all of these things. And then we also might need to share code between the two UDP socket and TCP socket tests for IP-related things. But notice, we didn't pull out IP from TCP until we needed it, right? Now, depending on the specifics of your design, you might have found that it was simple to have an IP class, but I suspect that not. I suspect that like parsing the IP headers and then parsing the TCP headers would actually have been simpler to start off if you were only writing TCP in one class. I don't know for sure, but maybe it would have been. And so that gives us an overview of the system of incremental development and design. I talk a little bit more about it in the book, and I also talk a little bit more about it on my blog.
Great. Well, I had a couple questions I wanted to ask you that you'd given this talk in another environment, and there's some questions that came up there that I thought were great that I thought the audience would love to hear. And the first one is if your main users are in the in a certain language, what's the best way to build in internationalization off the bat?
Sure. So, and this question deals with a point that I made earlier in one of our previous talks about that internationalization is something that's really hard to bolt on later.
Yeah.
So you need to sort of know about it in advance, but you don't want to be too generic. You don't want to go beyond your incremental development step, right? And so what you want is you want some sort of layer or some really simple code that allows you to add internationalization in the future, but doesn't implement it now, right? So for example, if you're using like getText, you know, you have the underscore method that you can surround strings by. So just make sure that every string is surrounded by the right method that would do the translation, because that's really the hard part. The hard part is figuring out the strings, making sure that you're not trying to build sentences out of words because you can't translate things that way, because you have to translate whole sentences. Just implement good practices at the beginning that have to do with internationalization, but which don't add any significant complexity to your development.
Okay, so adding on to that, you said internationalization is something that's really hard to bolt on later after mm-hmm. you've made the app. Could you give a couple items that you've seen in your experience that are just as hard to bolt on later that people should think about ahead of time?
So the first thing that comes to mind is unit tests.
Unit tests, okay. Yeah.
That it is really, really hard to add unit tests to a system that was not designed for unit tests. People start off, they think, well, I'll just write some big end-to-end test because my system is really simple and that's all I need to do. But then once your system reaches, 50,000 or 100,000 lines and you want to go back and try to unit test all the things and you've designed them in a way that, like, for example, they're all tied to the database. So Bugzilla was designed this way where it didn't have any unit tests and everything was designed as the constructor would load things from the database. And that is really, really hard to test, particularly when the constructor is writing raw SQL. So there's not even like a layer that you can mock out that can like give you the data that you need. And so that is probably the first thing that comes to mind. I'm sure there's other things, but that's sort of like the big one.
Great. So when you train people in these three flaws and how to avoid them, and you go back and look at their code maybe 2 or 3 months later, what's their biggest failing?
That they didn't believe me? Because this is not my opinion. This is not me stating something that like, oh, I think this is what I should do. This is actually the result of a fair bit of research and experience and experiment that I did to develop the laws in the book and these rules. So it's not just me saying like, well, I think you should do this because I'm some sort of authority. Like you can ignore me or not know anything about me and these should still be true, right?
Yeah.
You don't need to respect me or talk to me or anything or hire me to do anything. But people, they weren't strict enough. They thought, well, I can be too generic sometimes this is really a situation where I just need to be overly generic or I'm sure that I can write this code even though I'm only going to need it, I'm just going to need it tomorrow and I'll just write it now. They just didn't actually follow the laws or the rules here completely as though they were actual rules.
Great. And the last question we got was around tools to help. I mean, I feel like you kind of explained it with the incremental design, but is there any other tools you suggest using to help you avoid the three flaws?
Yeah, I think having a really strong code review process is really good. Having automated dead code detection can be really helpful, particularly code that's only run by tests, right? So you have code that doesn't actually get used anywhere in your system, even though it gets exercised by tests. Mm-hmm. Which is, by the way, occasionally okay. If you're gonna, if the only time that I'm ever like, well, whenever a developer says, no, I'm really gonna use this in like 5 minutes. I'm really gonna use it in 5 minutes. Like my next change is gonna use this code. I say, okay, well, write a test. So that way at least it's being used by something so that I can prove that it's actually useful or I can see an API that makes sense. But I still try to say, like, just wait until normally I would say just wait until you need it in the next time. So I would say code review tools, you know, having a good bug tracker, having a good way to keep track of either cleanup tasks or refactorings that you need to do can really help. But really, code review and the discipline surrounding that is probably the most important tool.
Great. Well, Max, thanks for taking the time to meet with us and talk through the three flaws and ways to avoid them. We really appreciate that. And thank you, audience, for joining us. Again, if this is the first video you've seen, we have a whole series. Please check them out. And we hope to see you soon.